What a beautiful time of worship. And interesting enough, my subject on what I'm speaking on is worship this morning. And it's an amazing time that we worship. I remember last Sunday, Donnie had it on his heart for us to go into an extended time of worship, and he changed the order of the service, where Munya preached first, and then we went into a wonderful time of worship. And then Donnie started the Wednesday evening worship here in this house, Wednesday evenings from 6:30 to 7:30, and it's just a wonderful time of worship and coming into his presence. And as a house, as Kabot Ministries, we value worship very highly. And worship is so, so important in this house. And you know, when you look, there are different ways of worship. There are different ways churches worship. I grew up in this church when I was little, and even after we got married, we were part of this church, the traditional Dutch Reformed church. And I remember we were always sitting almost where Philippa would sit. That was our seat there. And we had to come with our tie and suit on, and we had our traditional way of worship, very quiet, and you don't look around. And when I was still small, if I happened to look around, my mom would pinch me on the leg or something and say, you know. So that was the way of worship. And but that doesn't mean God doesn't honor that, because God honors worship. It doesn't matter how you do it. But what does worship look like in church? How should we worship? And we're going to look at a few things, and there's no better way than getting answers from the Word of God. Right? If we read the Word of God and we listen to what God says about worship, then we can't go wrong if we worship according to the Word of God. Amen. So we're going to look at a lot of scripture this morning. I gave the scriptures to Donovan at the back there, and he's frantically typing in there. I was a bit late giving him the scriptures, but it's good to have a look at the scriptures on the board. But you know, God is love. Amen? And God passionately pursues us. His unconditional love. As we are, no matter where we are, no matter what we've done, he loves us unconditionally. We don't have to earn his love. We don't have to work for his love. He loves us as we are. And that's the amazing thing about him. And he desires that relationship with us. And from our side, it is important that we honor him and express our love to him, our devotion to him, and in the form of worship. And we do that through our worship. Like this morning was amazing. The presence. Who felt the presence here this morning? It was just amazing to just know that the Spirit of the living God is here in our presence. So we're going to start off with just one scripture in John 4. And it's where Jesus came through Samaria, and he came to the well where he met the Samaritan woman. And then in verse 23, he says this, and it's on the board there. And I've got the New King James Version, so it's slightly different there. He says, "But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him." The Father is seeking such to worship him. In spirit and in truth. What we were doing this morning is we are worshiping him in spirit and in truth. We were aglow with the Holy Spirit. And in truth, we come with honesty, we come with sincerity, we come with total surrender to him, and we worship him and give ourselves totally to him. Amen? And so that's what the Lord wants. He wants that worship, and it's a beautiful expression of our love to him. is when you look at a wonderful marriage between husband and wife, and Jesus, the bride, and the bridegroom Jesus. That relationship between husband and wife is a beautiful expression of love, and that's how we should be to our bridegroom as the bride, to express our love to him, and he expresses his love towards us, that beautiful relationship. And in that relationship, he desires us to worship him and acknowledge him and give our adoration to him and our praises to him. Amen. So their different cultures have different ways of worship. The Shona people, man, I go to farms, ministering in the farms, in the grading sheds, and there's no instruments, but the way they worship, and they it's just this unity among them when they start singing is just incredible. Us Western people, we're a bit more reserved, you know, we're in our place, and we don't really move about like our brothers and sisters. But we're going to get there. We'll definitely get there. I remember years ago in the early 90s, we leased a farm in Rusapi, and I think some of you have heard this story. The second day we were on the farm, the owner of the farm invited us for dinner. And we came, and just after dinner he said to us, if I may ask, which church do you belong to? And I said, well, we're in the Dutch Reformed Church in Rusapi. And he says, oh, that's good, that's good. I said, why? He says, just watch out. Just down the road, there's a church called the Grace Fellowship. And they weird people. I said, why? He says, they wave their arms, their hands in the air, and they speak in these funny, ghosty languages, and they jump up and down. They're a weird bunch. And I said, well, I'm staying away from that church. And little did I know, many years later, I'd be jumping up and down for God. But folks, in the end, it's not about us. It's about him. It's all about him and what pleases him. That is the important. We forget about ourselves. This morning, I just noticed we're forgetting about ourselves. It's not about us. It's about him. And that pleases God. Amen. And when we come to church, we come with expectancy. We come with just remembering what he did for us on that cross. For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only begotten Son. He sent his Son. Jesus came and he gave his life for us. He was a sinless man on this earth, giving his life for us in exchange for our sin. He took our sin upon him and reconciled us to Father God. Man, that should make us just excited to know what he did for us. And when we come into church, we worship him with thinking, with gladness, what he did for us, with gratefulness, with thankfulness in our hearts, what he did for us on that cross, and we worship him. You know, and different people express their worship in different ways. Some people, and not today, but some people look quite bored when they worship. In the old church, we had one guy that would stare out the window while we were worshiping. Not really interested in the worship. And how many of you have watched the latest World Cup soccer game or the World Cup rugby game? The stadium is full of people, about 40, 50, 60,000 people. The World Cup cricket that has just finished now, the stadium in India took 130,000 people. Have you noticed when someone scores that goal in the last minute or kicks a drop goal in that very last second and wins the game and people jump up and they go wild and hug people, even the person you don't even know the person next to you, they just hug each other. And that's just someone chasing a ball. But we've got an almighty God who loves us. Shouldn't we be extravagant in our worship and praise him and be excited about him? Amen? Are you excited about him? Amen. I remember, Donnie, was it 2 years ago you showed the soccer final? in the hall next door, Danny had it on the big screen, the soccer final. And some of you were there. And man, you wouldn't believe the crazy people that were there. They went wild. And yeah, they sit in church. I'm only joking. We must go wild for Jesus. We must be extravagant in our worship and love him and bless him. It must be passionate. It must be radical. And just remembering what he did for us on that cross. And we don't always just worship in spirit. We worship in our bodies. Our body language just shows how we love him and how we care for him. Donovan, can you just go to Luke 10:27? And this is Jesus saying, and he answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. Isn't that just everything in us? Our whole body just honoring God, our strength, our mind, our soul, everything. We just worship him with everything that we have. Romans 12:1. We're going to do a lot of scripture. He says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Giving ourselves as living sacrifice, our whole body, our whole being, we just give it to him and worship him. Everything that we have. How would you react if you get a message from a lawyer saying that there was a great aunt of yours in the UK, you didn't even know about her, and she's left you with £1 million or $1 million. How would you react? I don't know about you, but I will jump up and down, yay! And I'll grab Aniki and I'll dance with her. We got $1 million. Or would you say, oh, I'm grateful, I'm thankful. How would you react? Ngoni, how would you react? Demonstrate to us. It's just so joyful to just worship God, man. Here's the problem. Many of us we have pride in our lives. We have fear of man in our lives. We are shy because we don't know what this person next to us is going to think. He might think this is a weird guy, and we don't want people. Maybe there's a first-time visitor sitting next to you, and you don't want to just express yourself because you're shy or you have the fear of man. I encourage you, don't worry about the person next to you. You know, I don't think when God handed out voices, I don't think I was right up top there. So I don't have a very good voice, but man, I don't care who hears me, or I just go for it. When I'm in my office and I close the door and I start worshiping, I've got my earphones in and I'm just singing as loud as I can. And I think I'm singing beautifully. Really, oh man, I've got this awesome voice. And then Aniki says, you must hear yourself. But I don't care. I just worship him because I love him and I just pour out my affections upon him. Amen. So let's look at King David for a moment. Apart from Jesus, he was the greatest king, I believe, ever. And let's see how David reacts. Let's go to 2 Samuel 6, verse 14. And we're going to go on to verse 16. Wearing a linen ephod. Now, some people say he was dancing naked, but he wasn't quite naked. He had this priestly ephod on, which is something that you wear in the front and the back, and it's tied with like laces, yeah. So I don't know what else he had on, but that's all he had on. And David was dancing before the Lord with all his might, while he and all Israel were bringing up the ark of the Lord with what? Shouts and the sounds of trumpets. And the ark of the Lord was entering the city of David. Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. And when she saw King David leaping, see, you hear that? Leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. King David, the king of Israel, dancing and leaping with just the linen ephod on, didn't care about anything, and his wife despised him. And God struck her barren, and I believe that's because God values worship highly. Amen? Verse 20 to 22. And then David replies to her after she accuses him. He says, I will become even more undignified than this, and I will be humiliated in my own eyes. But by these slave girls you spoke of, I will be held in honor. So David says, yeah, I will be even more undignified when his wife accused him. David, the king of Israel, just worshipped God with everything he had. Dancing, leaping. It's some scriptures say he was twirling. In other words, he was just jumping and turning in the air. And that was just expressing how he loved God and how he worshipped God. Amen? Remember, I'm quoting scripture from the Word of God. It's not I'm saying there's a new doctrine in the church that we have to do this. It's the Word of God. Amen? And so we gather on a Sunday, and we come with gladness. We come with joy. We come to express our gratitude, and we extravagantly worship him. This morning was a perfect example of worshiping him in spirit and in truth. And I heard a pastor once say, and I listened to a sermon, and he said, how can people come late for worship? How can people come late for worship? Some even after worship, do they realize who God is? Do they realize who we're meeting here in the house of God as a family together? I've got a friend. I've been trying to get him into church for a long while. And he came once to, when we were still in the old building, and he came once to a conference here. And I said, why don't you come to church? He says, because he's still got a bit of a traditional mindset. He said, man, you guys sing too long. He says, and you sing one verse over and over and over. Can you see how he sees worship? He sees worship as coming and doing one or two songs, and then that's finished and done with. Let's get on with the service so I can go home. That's not worship. Sometimes we can be, may not even share the Word of God. This morning I was almost sensing we're not going to share the Word this morning because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Who enjoyed the worship this morning? Amen. That was awesome. And I want to encourage you, and that's what I said in the beginning, one of our key values at Kabot Ministries is we value worship highly. And it's a key part of our service. And so I just encourage everyone here, invite friends, encourage them. When we come together to worship, let people see how you worship. We've got Herbert and Doreen here, first-time visitors, and Sarah there, first-time visit. And the lady at the back there, I don't know your name yet, but I'll get to you just now. But they now experienced the true worship that we do here at Kabot Ministries. And I saw them participating, and I believe they enjoyed the worship. Did you? Amen. Because when people come in, they need to see how we worship God and how we love him and express our adoration to him. And sometimes you might come to church, you've got a heavy burden. You might even think, oh, I don't feel like going to church today. I'm just so tired. I'm just so worn down. I'm these burdens are just pressing me down. That's when you have to come to church. That's when you come and it's not about your circumstance. It's about Him and worshiping Him. And many, many times, if not all the times, as you worship Him and as you praise Him, you'll feel those burdens lifting off you. Amen? So we must come and gather here on time before our worship starts so that we as a family can get into our worship together. And I can bet you, if you have got an appointment with the president of the country, you will be there on time, won't you? If you're going to meet him, you're not going to be, you'd rather be half an hour early sitting waiting for the president. Are we serving the King of Kings? How can we not honor him with our worship and praise and be on time and seek him and just praise him together as a family? And you know, I don't know about you, but some of the most intense, wonderful moments I've had with the Lord, his presence just overwhelming, is when I in time of worship. Even in my secret place, in my office at the home there, I close the door and I've had some major awesome encounters with God. Sometimes I just start crying because of that presence, the holiness of God. So the Bible uses some wonderful words to describe worship. And there's plenty of words in the word. But the one word that stands out is the Hebrew word yada. If you go, and you don't have to go there, Genesis 4, verse 1, it says, Adam knew Eve. The Hebrew word means Adam yada Eve. Yada means that intimate relationship where a husband and wife for the first time come in union together in that intimacy. That is what this expresses, the yada, that relationship with the Lord. He is the bridegroom. We are the bride, and we need to come and intimately be with him. That's what he seeks. In the New Testament, and I don't know if I'm pronouncing right, but the Greek word is proskuneo, and that means an intimate fellowship, or to bow down low and kiss his hand. That's what that means. It's referred to 60 times in the New Testament. So the next question we have is, what does the Bible say? How does he want us to worship? And so we're going to look at a few scriptures now, and we're going to go through them quickly because of time. And so Psalm 149 verse 1. Praise the Lord. Now this is the word of God. Praise the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of his faithful people. Praise to the Lord, sing a song, and he talks about the assembly of the saints. Okay? We gather here, we sing to him, we praise and worship him together. Psalm 47 verse 1, what does it say? Clap your hands, all you nations. What does it say? Shout to God with cries of joy. Come on. Clap your hands. Shout, Jesus. I didn't hear that one. Yeah, you guys can't shout. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. That's a bit better. And you know, sometimes when we sing and there's a verse that says, and he conquered the grave, we should be, yes, he conquered the grave. And we shout with joy because he conquered the grave. He overcame the sting of death. He rose from the grave. Yay! Amen? Come on. Psalm 149 verse 3, and I'm not good at this one. Let him praise his name with dancing. And make music to him with timbrel and harp. I'm not very good at dancing. I don't have the rhythm, but we must dance in church. to bring a joyful sound to Him, to worship Him with joy and just love Him with instruments. I remember we had a guy in the early days in the Vineyard Church. We gathered there in the theater where they had the movies. It's now a bar. But the stage there had this thing going down at a curve. And Martinez de Beer would play the guitar. And he would play and he'd just go into worship. And as he worships, the Holy Spirit comes upon him and he slides down. And eventually he just lies on the floor with a guitar on top of him, under the power of the Holy Spirit. And we had to physically carry him to his car because of the anointing. Dancing before the Lord with instruments. Acts 3 verse 8. Now this is just after John and Peter healed the guy that from birth was lame and he couldn't walk. And they prayed for him and he jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple, walking and jumping and praising God. Babette is very good at jumping. We'll see her later. She's going to demonstrate to us how you dance and jump. Okay, Babette? All right. But then there's also time of deep worship, where we come into His presence. And let's look at 2 Chronicles 7, 1, 2, 3. When Solomon finished praying, they had just dedicated the temple that they had built. When Solomon finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. Just wait there. The glory of the Lord. What is that word in Hebrew? It's kabod. It's our church name. The weightiness of His presence filled the temple. The priests could not enter the temple of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled it. When all the Israelites saw the fire coming down and the glory of the Lord above the temple, they knelt on the pavement with their faces to the ground, and they worshipped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, He is good, His love endures forever. There's some scriptures where they say they fell flat on their faces before the Lord. And that's that holiness, that presence that you so in, you're just in deep worship. There's no dancing, there's no jumping, there's just lying before Him, kneeling before Him, bowing before Him, and just worshiping the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. 1 Timothy 2 verse 8. Therefore, I want the men everywhere to pray, doing what? Lifting up holy hands, without anger or disputing, lifting up holy hands. I was part of this church. As I've said to before, Duval was also part of this church. And there was no such thing as lifting your hands. There was nothing like that. You didn't lift your hands, you stood like this. But then we had an encounter with God and we moved out of the church and we planted the Vineyard Church. And Anik and I and Donnie and my eldest son Paul went there for the first time. And we had church under a tree. And there were musical instruments, guitar and a keyboard and I don't know what other instruments. And I just came and I looked at this and already this was now, because I'm used to that organ at the back there. And then they start playing and they start, and they're lifting up their hands. And I was still so shy and I was looking around. I didn't want to lift my hands. And eventually I got to just doing this. And they called me a penguin worshiper. But eventually, yay, lifting up the hands and worshiping Him. Folks, there are many more scriptures. I don't have time to go into them. There are scriptures in 1 Corinthians 14 about singing in the Spirit. You speak in tongues, but you sing in tongues. And then there's scripture, Psalm 46, verse 10, that it says, just be still and know that I'm God, where you're just quiet in His presence. Did you know, and we all know that God honors us with his presence like this morning. And he's here at the very moment. He's listening in. He's watching over us. He's here. But did you know he responds to our worship? And I want to show you from Scripture, Zephaniah 3, verse 17. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. I just want to read that passage from the ESV scripture, the translation. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exalt you over you with loud singing. Can you see, when we worship him, he responds. He sings over us. He delights over us. He rejoices over us. So it's not a one-way thing, because God honors us with his presence. And on top of that, he's singing over us. He's rejoicing over us because his bride is worshiping him, loving him. And he responds by pouring out his love upon us and his presence. Amen? Relationships is two-way. You can't have a relationship just one way. God desires relationship. He desires intimacy. But we must respond, and that comes through our act of worship. So, folks, I've gone through this very quickly because of time. I would have loved to go more deeply into everything, but I think you get the idea, because everything is in the Word of God. I really hope and trust that this has connected with you and stirred your hearts and really encouraged you to take worship seriously. It is so important to worship him. And as I said, we as a church, we value worship very highly. And I know Donnie, as the pastor now, values worship so highly. And him and Ngoni and all the other team, Philippa and everyone, they are now bringing in worship to the next level. We can see their hearts. We can see they're growing. We can see where they're going. And they're doing it on Wednesday nights. They're giving their time in that. And we as a congregation need to support them and come along and worship God with them. Amen? I want you to be honest. Who of you have danced before the Lord lately? Four of us. Who of you have shouted with praise lately? We've all done that just now. But in your home, how do you shout? Who of you have jumped before the Lord lately? Donovan, two hands, yes. Well, I want us as a congregation to end off our service with jumping, shouting, praising what the Lord has said in the Word of God. Let us stand.